All right, good morning. Good morning and aloha. Before I begin, I want to acknowledge our entire cabinet and our deputy directors, directors and deputy directors. I also want to acknowledge the council members that are here. Chair Tommy Waters from District 4, Vice Chair Esther Kia Aina from District 3, our floor leader Andrea Tupolo from District 1, Heidi Sunayoshi from District 2, Calvin Say from District 5, Carol Fukunaga from District 6, Radiant Cordero from District 7, and Brandon Elefante from District 8, who are both of whom are in Washington, D.C. right now, and Augie Toba from District 9, along with my wife, Karen Chang, and our friend, Laurie Foster. We're all here today in attendance at the Mission Memorial Auditorium. So I want to thank each and every one of them for all of their hard work, dedication, and all-around grit in working together in our first year in office. Under some very difficult conditions, nonetheless, we prevailed as a result of the COVID-19 pandemic. I am humbled by your passion, caring, and your hard work for the people we serve together. You know, I have no words for the gratitude I feel in my heart for all of you and the incredible honor I have in serving as mayor. Now, after 14 months in office, I am most privileged to deliver my second State of the City address. Last year's address was somewhat limited because we had only been in office for slightly more than 60 days. However, our initial efforts during that time provided the strong foundation needed for our team to address the many challenges facing the city and county of Honolulu, as well as our administration. Now, we've been determined not to allow the pandemic to stop us from doing what we were elected to do. COVID required us to respond and recover simultaneously, and it also required us to make challenging decisions involving the safety and well-being of our people and businesses. And by their nature, crises tend to exacerbate existing weaknesses in operating systems, and we quickly understood our vulnerability as we worked diligently to figure out our best path forward. Now, it's been a gut-wrenching journey through the tier system we found in place coming into office, followed by the onslaught of the deadly Delta variant last September, and finally, battling through the aggressive and highly contagious Omicron variant for the past several months. So 10 days ago, we dropped the last of our restrictions, Safe Access Oahu. So I very much would like to express my most sincere and a tremendous appreciation to our residents and communities throughout our island who fought back bravely right from the outset against this disease. Through their positive actions and genuine concern for others in getting vaccinated, mask wearing, and socially distancing when appropriate, we achieved remarkable results against the dangerous spread of this disease. And to our healthcare professionals and first responders, there are no words to express the incredible gratitude we all feel for your tireless work and loving care that you extended to the many thousands of people who really needed you during these challenging times. We will never forget your truly heroic and completely unselfish giving of all you had to give to help so many of us. So please, allow me to be that voice of profound respect and deep appreciation for the countless thousands of people whose lives you touched forever. Thank you. Now, we all go forward together, determined to put this dreadful and at times terrifying experience behind us as we look to regain the balance in all aspects of our lives. Now, I want to start off talking about a budget overview. Our key areas of our focus for the fiscal year 2023 budget include improved delivery of core city and county of Honolulu services to the people, modernizing government, greater efficiency, investing in people, accountability and excellence in service, diversifying economic sectors with a focus on job growth, and establishing new processes to provide transparent and equitable relief to those struggling to make ends meet. Now, the budget emphasizes our commitment to reduce homelessness, to build affordable housing, to prioritize public safety, to improve intermodal transportation, including a functional rail system the city can afford, and improve infrastructure with a focus on climate change adaptation projects. We want to take better care of our parks and expand our park facilities. And we want to increase fiber optic connectivity and transition to a state-of-the-art traffic signal technology. We want to renovate our public municipal facilities, and we want to jumpstart our electrification of transportation, all the while prioritizing sustainable, resilient, and responsible economic growth on Oahu. You know, the city is also committed to responsibly fund 100% of the annual required contribution of $188.1 million for current and future retirees' health care benefits, known as OPEB. As we eagerly look to put COVID behind us, we fully recognize we are dealing with another crisis, decades in the making, a housing crisis, where demand grossly exceeds our housing inventory at all income levels. Now, we are laying the foundation to set new growth targets in this sector by taking the opportunity to reopen and rethink how we work collectively and smartly with public and private stakeholders. This includes working diligently to strengthen the alignment between the city's priorities and projects with state, federal, and non-governmental resources. And lastly, I want to be on record stating that every line in this comprehensive budget of more than $4.1 billion is directed at restoring confidence, faith, and trust in our city and county Honolulu government through superior performance and earned credibility. That is a really important part of everything we've put down and something we're going to live up to. So I want to start off by homelessness. I want to talk about the homeless situation. We are determined to take an innovative approach in addressing the unacceptable conditions of our homeless problem, which has severely impacted all of us here on Oahu for a very long time, and for that matter, many cities all across the mainland. Now, we strongly believe that past city practices, while well-intended, were not effective in providing a workable strategy inclusive of the necessary resources to get our homeless population off the streets. Most importantly, the city was failing our homeless and not providing them with real help in dealing with their medical issues, mental health problems, and substance abuse. You know, the street is not a home, and we cannot keep looking the other way with people sleeping on sidewalks, at bus stops, in doorways, or under freeways. Now, with collaboration from our Department of Community Services, the Mayor's Office of Housing and Homelessness, as well as our Emergency Services Department, we have launched a new City and County of Honolulu program called CORE, Crisis, Outreach, Response, and Engagement, CORE. Now, this is a new and completely different way to engage the homeless population with a solution-oriented approach that focuses on medical, social, and mental health needs. Now, we've converted 4 retired city ambulances and 3 retired EMS SUVs to bring the appropriate care to the homeless on the streets. And though only a few months old, we already have a team of 17 community health workers and emergency medical technicians, which will significantly expand by the end of this year. Now, this team is fully dedicated to solving homelessness head-on in our parks, on our streets, in our sidewalks, and in our public spaces. This team not only responds to calls, but proactively seeks out those living on the streets or in distress. CORE will also act as a liaison between all the other government and community partners, bringing synergy and efficiency in combating homelessness. Now, we know mental illness and substance abuse is prevalent in the homeless population. So focusing on treatment centers and stabilization shelters that can handle these issues is very much key. So since we currently don't have enough of these specialized facilities, we are making this another top priority. So in addition to existing city properties, we are taking steps to expand our stabilization housing inventory near existing treatment resources. And we will do this by partnering with our nonprofits and others, such as the medical school, JAPSN, in all of our nursing schools. So together, we strongly believe we can get this done. So we have the right strategy, and we are developing the resources. But I want to stress, our key challenge is that once CORE identifies those in crisis and gets them off the streets, we must have places to take care of them and ultimately house them. So we fully recognize people on the streets are human beings. They are our brothers and sisters, and we simply cannot leave them behind. You know, it's gratifying to report that our Oahu Housing Now! Program, using available CARES Act funding, set an ambitious target for itself 1 year ago. This month, to rebuild a minimum of 300 households who are currently experiencing homelessness. And on February 23, 2022, the City and County of Honolulu's Department of Community Services and its lead agent, Partners in CARE, met its goal of housing its 300th household, representing 787 individuals. So I want to extend my most heartfelt appreciation and gratitude to Laura E. Thielen, the Executive Director for Partners in CARE, and her project team of Housing Solutions, Inc., who handles the monthly rental payments. This was no small achievement. Also, a special mahalo to Family Promise of Hawaii and Alternative Structures International, both of whom provided much-needed wraparound case management services. And I would also be remiss in not recognizing Connie Mitchell and IHS for their enduring work with the homeless on Oahu for a very long time. Oahu Housing Now! Gives us a chance to address new groups like the working homeless and provide them with very real opportunities to succeed. And more importantly, more than half of the families that were housed under Oahu Housing Now! Were from the most vulnerable of our COVID-19 populations, Native Hawaiians and Pacific Islanders. So now, to sustain these critical programs, the city must update its financial payment system and make sure our partner resource agencies have timely access to funds and And today, I commit that the city will take the necessary steps to make this happen. You have our word on that. Okay, I want to talk about the rail. Our transition and taking over the responsibility for completing the rail was challenging, to say the very least, given all that had preceded us. Facing a history of cost overruns, an inadequate budget, and delayed construction timetables, including a disillusioned public and our wary and concerned partner, the Federal Transit Administration, or the FTA, our first order of business was to regroup the team of city leaders and key principals overseeing the construction and ultimately the operations of the rail, a team that had all but quit working together during harsh time spent pursuing a public-private partnership. This regroup team included the newly installed CEO and her executive team at HART, the chair of the City Council, Tommy Waters, the chair of the HART Board, Ms. Colleen Hanabusa, our senior leadership team from our Department of Transportation Services, who will be responsible for the operations and maintenance once we begin providing service, as well as our managing director, Mike Formby, and myself. Now, we met weekly since taking office with the intent of determining our financial and our technical capacity with respect to the construction and the operation of the rail. We have also continuously updated the FTA on our progress as we worked to truly understand the reality of rail. You know, coming into office, one of my core beliefs in running a business is to understand the numbers. I said throughout, if the numbers don't make sense, the strategy doesn't make sense. We came in with that philosophy, committed to developing a strategy for the completion of a functional rail system, which translates into building the rail system that serves the riders by going as far as possible based on the available funding sources. And coming into office, I knew one thing for sure. The numbers supported going beyond Middle Street, and Middle Street would never be a functional stopping point for the community that will depend upon and ride rail. You know, as a practical matter, over the last year, we simply asked ourselves, given our responsibility and commitment to the people of Oahu and the FTA, what does success look like based on the financial resources available to us? So last Friday, I met with Ms. Noria Fernandez, the administrator for the FTA in Washington, D.C., to provide her with background information on our efforts since taking office to manage the rail project. as well as to get an update from her on the status of our partnership with the FTA from her perspective. I also wanted to advise her that after months of work, we're in the process of completing our recovery plan for submission by June 30th, and that our strategy includes receiving the entire remaining balance of $744 million in FTA funds, funds essential to delivering a functional rail system to the people. That meeting was followed later in the day with another meeting with Lori Kaikina, Executive Director and Chief Executive Officer of the Honolulu Authority for Rapid Transportation, or HART, and Mr. Roger Morton, our Director of the Department of Transportation Services. We wanted to assure the FTA that the recovery plan we will be submitting was tracking according to their expectations. And we also wanted to leave Administrator Fernandez and her team with a sense of the economic, political, and management hurdles we have overcome and will continue to overcome in our unwavering commitment to deliver a functional rail system for the people within our city's financial capacity. Everything I'm about to say is subject to the FTA approval, and we will not have any official approval from them until after they have fully vetted our plan. I asked for permission to share the fundamental elements of our plan, and they agreed I could talk about it publicly for the first time, provided I stress our plan is not yet officially approved. Currently, we are bound by a full funding grant agreement known as the FFGA to our construction partner, the FTA, which was signed by Mayor Carlisle in 2012 to build a rail system to the following scope: 20 miles and 21 stations, 24 car trains, and build it from East Kapolei through downtown to El Moana Center. In submitting our recovery plan to the FTA, we will propose we amend the FFGA to the following scope: 18.75 miles or 19 stations. Build it from East Kapolei through downtown to the Civic Center station, which is approximately Halekuʻiwila and South Street, which is 1.25 miles and two stations short of Ala Moana Center. Our recovery plan will also require value engineering and deferral, not elimination, of the currently planned Pearl Highlands parking garage, which is currently on the books at a project cost of $330 million for 1,600 stalls at a cost of $206,000 per stall with negligible impact on ridership. It is very important to note, however, we will build the Pearl Highlands Bus Transit Center and the H2 highway access ramp to optimize readership for those coming from Central Oahu and the North Shore. We believe this creates a highly functional rail system through Pearl Harbor, through the airport, and the downtown corridor, all major employment centers. Now, the current combined state GET TAT, the new city TAT, the FFGA $1.55 billion, and the city's original commitment of $214 million will provide approximately $9.8 billion in projected funds. And consequently, this also provides us the financial capacity needed to complete the project as we are proposing. So this represents $9.1 billion in construction cost and $650 million in financing cost with a little bit of a cushion. However, our commitment to continue refining our project costs going downward is going to be paramount in our efforts. So as an additional update, HART recently completed 100% of the design work for the utility relocations in the downtown corridor, starting in Ivalay and through Chinatown, downtown, and Civic Center. All designs were done according to design standards and approved by the city and third-party utilities. Now, this is something HART has struggled to accomplish in the past. We're also very pleased to report that a solution has been found to the wheel-reel alignment. That's where the wheels were thinner than the tracks. That also includes a manganese weld repair of the track. Now, the nine most western stations from Kapolei towards the urban corridor are complete, and the next four stations are more than 60% complete, along with the fact that the guideway structure all the way to Middle Street is also complete. So that means that 75% of the guideway, starting at East Kapolei, has been built. We've also received 18 of the car trains. So as of today, we are anticipating and preparing for the first operating segment of the rail system to be turned over to the city later this calendar year in 2022 or early 23 at the latest. However, this will require the successful completion of the 90-day trial running period, and we expect to be providing service from East Kapolei to Aloha Stadium once that is done. Now, the Department of Transportation Services, because this has always been an intermodal project, will redesign existing bus routes and implement new services to provide seamless connections to and from the rail line. Some of these services will focus on connecting our residential communities to the rail. And all the services will be implemented to provide frequent express trips on both ends of the rail line. These express trips will connect both end-of-the-line rail stations to Kapolei's Kamakana Ali'i Center and downtown Kapolei and points beyond on the west side, as well as Kaka'ako, Ala Moana Center, Waikiki, and UH Manoa in the east. So we want to especially encourage college students to use public transit. The Honolulu rail system is currently designed to link up three University of Hawaii campuses plus the Hawaii Pacific University, or HPU, campus, with an eventual expansion to UH Manoa. Together, these campuses today serve more than 35,000 students. UH Manoa continues to be an important focal point for our transit system. When interim rail opens, we will provide a streamlined, limited-stop City Express service to the UH Manoa campus, along with four other major bus routes. All students at the UH Manoa campus, together with students at Kapi'olani Community College and the Hawaii Pacific University, participate in our UPass program, in which all students are entitled to low-cost transit service through an agreement with participating schools. You know, we're working hard to integrate campus activity cards with our rail HoloCard system, so students only need to tap their activity card rather than having to carry multiple cards. So we're very proud of that. It's going to be a really big lift for our student population. Effective on December 14, 2021, Bill 40 gave the city authority to levy the Oahu Transient Accommodations Tax, or TAT, at a higher rate than previously allocated by the state. The effective tax rate of 3% will result in budgeted TAT revenue of approximately $86 million in fiscal year 2023. Prior to COVID-19, the state's allocation of TAT to Honolulu was about $45 million per year. Now, our planned allocation of the revenue will have 33 1/3 of the TAT revenue, or approximately $28.6 million, going to the rail project in the first 2 years, and then 50%, or roughly $43 million, thereafter in perpetuity. And the balance of the TAT revenue will help to optimize and cover core services and the many demands in operating the city and county of Honolulu, including critical funds to operate and maintain our parks and preserve our natural resources. So first and foremost, Bill 40, now Ordinance 2133, reinforces our financial commitment to build a functional rail project, adding credibility to our financial capacity of our recovery plan. And that will be submitted to the FTA in June, as I said earlier. You know, we're confident that Ordinance 2133 will help greatly in securing the FTA's approval of the revised recovery plan, which will trigger the much-needed release of $744 million, the remaining federal commitment funds under the full funding grant agreement. And we have every confidence in the future of the rail. And we know it will have a transformative and positive impact on our communities, leading to a better quality of life for generations to come. Because fundamentally, rail will not only connect people and communities, it will connect people with jobs, recreation, businesses, education, entertainment, service providers, and maybe most importantly, healthcare. It will also stimulate the development of affordable housing and provide those dependent on transit with faster, more efficient service. So in closing on the rail, while our recovery plan will propose to adjust the East Side Terminus to the Civic Center Station in Kaka'ako, which will allow the city to receive full federal funds per the FFGA funds, which have not been released since 2017, we still believe in a future connection someday of rail to UH Manoa. But for now, we must move forward with a project that is functional and within the city's financial means. You know, it took a lot of work by many professionals to get to this place, but in the end, the numbers dictate the strategy. And this strategy makes sense for Oahu residents, transit riders, and taxpayers. Proud of it. I said earlier we're facing a crisis in housing. I want to talk about affordable housing. In a 2019 Hawaii Housing Planning Study assessing the unmet demand for housing on Oahu, the total units needed through 2025 was forecasted at 22,186, with 16,793 of those units at the 140% of the area median income, AMI, and below. Now, coming into office, we knew Oahu's unmet housing need was decades in the making. And our commitment was to rethink old ways and look for new solutions while getting things done. And I'm proud to say our team has been doing just that, driving execution while strategizing on new and different ways to incentivize and facilitate the development of housing versus the old way of trying to regulate our way out of this chronic situation. So not only did our team finalize the permits for the Hale Waiolu Senior Housing Project in Chinatown, which broke ground in June of 2021, in our first year, we formed an affordable housing working group to tear down silos and bring the many departments with a role in affordable housing to collaborate on acquisitions, projects, policies, and strategies. Now, this working group listened to those already working in the affordable housing sector and continues to listen, now meeting with and talking to affordable housing nonprofits and developers, gathering insight on what historically has not worked, why it hasn't worked, and what best practices could work in the future. Now, this working group assigns tasks that have already resulted in two new programs targeting the financial challenges to build affordable housing: the county's GET exemption program and a county program to issue tax-exempt private activity bonds to affordable housing developers. And that's a program that the city walked away from over 23 years ago. Now, this working group has also been assessing and prioritizing land acquisitions for affordable housing development by targeting those properties best situated with existing water and sewer capacity and utility connections, with three properties currently targeted for development, including the Royal Kunia boxcar lot, with not only affordable housing, but a child care center, another property in Waikiki currently planned for senior housing, and a property in Iwalei. And the city is also investing up to $30 million in the development of affordable housing inventory on Oahu, with the proposals currently under review by the Department of Community Services. Now, for existing projects, the city is prioritizing the Aiea Sugar Mill Senior Affordable Housing Project, Kapolei Lots 6 and 7, Westlock Affordable, Westlock Modular, a Pearl City apartment complex targeted for renovation and expansion, the Hawaii Resource Center in Iwalei, and 27 units in Iwalei, and Verona Village, which requires significant cross-sector work to move the project into development. When it comes to affordable housing, our administration is not only focused on acquiring land for future developments, acquiring existing properties for renovation, and adaptive reuse and fast-tracking existing projects that have yet to deliver inventory to the market, but we are focused on new policies, new best practices, and new strategies that will transform the city's role in affordable housing, away from being a regulator and towards facilitating and partnering with the affordable housing community. Now, the first step, which we've already accomplished, was identifying and breaking down the silos in the city that complicated and frustrated the timely development of affordable housing. And now we are on to step two: strong and regular collaboration across sectors with improved lines of authority, more efficient inventory management, new policies and best practices, and dedicated work towards the development of a new housing strategy and policy for the city and county of Honolulu. Affordable housing is one of my administration's top priorities, but we must understand the problem that has plagued our city for decades before we innovate new solutions. My team is on the right path, and I commit to you, their focused collective work will and is leading to better solutions in the years and decades ahead. I'm going to take a little drink of water here, if you don't mind. Tied to our housing strategy is the Department of Planning and Permitting, and I want to talk about that now. Our challenge in addressing decades of frustration and inexcusable delays in providing critical building permits, from simple remodeling projects to large-scale housing developments aimed at every economic sector, is nothing short of monumental. This department woefully lacked staffing, technology, resources, and efficient operating procedures. Now, a long history of audit-identified issues and challenges were, unfortunately, exacerbated by graft and corruption, as evidenced by the federal indictments and arrests of 5 employees shortly after we took office. Transforming the Department of Planning and Permitting is more than key to efficient city operations. It is absolutely vital to our island's housing needs and economic recovery from COVID. Consequently, from the onset of our taking office, DPP has assessed and evaluated the many varied policies and processes under the department's authority to identify gaps, inefficiencies, and irregularities. For example, to address rising concerns with third-party reviews, or TPR projects, due to reports of construction problems, non-compliance with codes and ordinances, and the federal indictments, the DPP initiated an audit of TPR, as allowed under the administrative rules, which discovered substantial shortfalls that are now being addressed. I mean, strikingly, the audit found that barely 50% of TPR projects met the requirements for permit issuance, an unacceptable result by any measure. So in a drive for much needed change, DPP has embarked on the modernization of DPP, permitting software and technologies for residential and commercial building permit applications. And that new system for residential permits is now 50% complete and will go live this year. We are also increasing the staffing levels dramatically at DPP. And our 3-year plan calls for an additional 80 people in addition to filling 80-plus vacancies. That's 160 people, which will also lend itself to a long overdue reorganization of the department to promote greater efficiency and, I might add, morale. We are fully committed to supporting and accelerating housing development, TOD project approvals, and infrastructure implementation in collaboration with other city departments, the state TOD council, and the entire development industry as a whole. As evidence of that commitment, and as mentioned earlier, DPP is restoring the city and county of Honolulu as an active issuer of tax-exempt private activity bonds. And the city is approving and exempting from general excise taxes any qualified person or firm involved in a newly constructed affordable housing project or a moderately or substantially rehabilitated affordable housing project. Now, this is about strategic and transformative change that will benefit our residents and strengthens the ability of the city to deliver affordable housing on a sustainable basis for years and decades to come. Now, from day one, our team has emphasized the need to address affordable housing for our residents, and these are significant steps forward toward long-term generational solutions. And on the issue of monster homes, we have recently revoked permits that were wrongfully issued, and will continue to be vigilant in this effort to ensure all home construction on Oahu complies with building codes and regulations. And a quick word about DPP solar, because one of the last important achievements at DPP was near the end of 2021. DPP moved the application and approval process for all residential solar photovoltaic, or PV, systems and PV battery permits with a material and methods approval from a very tedious and long-delayed over-the-counter experience to online, and this was significant. This will expedite and simplify permitting for solar PV companies and residential companies. And as of today, more than 55% of all online building permits are for residential solar PV or PV battery. And lastly, I want to discuss a very important piece of pending legislation that is of paramount importance on many levels to the future of Oahu. At the height of the pandemic, when visitors stopped coming to our shores, one positive result came to light. Illegal transient accommodations dropped dramatically, and our neighborhoods were returned to their residents. With Bill 41, we intend to preserve our culture and sense of place in our residential communities by banning all bed and breakfast and transient vacation rentals, except for those that are legally permitted to operate. And by limiting and better controlling the number of short-term rentals, we are opening up long-term rental housing for residents, which will help in addressing the current affordable housing crisis. The objective of Bill 41 is to stop the expansion of B&Bs and short-term rentals into residential zoned neighborhoods, but allows for expansion of vacation rentals in near select resort zone communities. Now, the bill is moving forward at the City Council and is expected to be heard by the Zoning and Planning Commission on March 23rd. If passed by the committee, Bill 41 will go to a third and final reading before the full City Council. And we ask that everyone who would like to see our neighborhoods return to our residents and the city better manage tourism and protect our precious natural resources to support Bill 41 at the City Council. I want to talk about a collection now of operating the city, and there's a number of departments in here. I want to start off with our Department of Information Technology. Simply put, operationally, we're not in sync with the fact that we are in the third year of the third decade of the 21st century. Now, this will take a widespread effort across nearly all of our departments on a sustained basis to get us there. However, we are closing big gaps in our pursuit of catching up with the future. Leading our team is our Department of Technology, or DIT, with a number of innovative solutions to facilitate city operations while providing better, streamlined, and more secure service to our residents and businesses. And to name just a few of the new and exciting developments, we'll start off with HNL Pay, a new digital payment platform that consolidates electronic payments across the city, handling card payments, paper and digitally submitted checks, full settlement and payment reconciliation, and integration into the city's financial system. The system was created without incurring any external services or developmental costs, and there are no recurring costs to maintain the system. And HNL Pay allows the city to expand the number of online services while reducing the integration effort. Our data center. A new state-of-the-art primary data center was built, utilizing automated cooling systems that reduce the required energy for cooling, densely packed servers, redundant lithium-ion backup systems, and utility feeds to ensure networks and applications remain available. Now, the new facility occupies almost 50% space, 50% less space, and is 30% more energy efficient than the old data center. An existing fiber optic cabling was replaced to provide greater capacity, higher speeds, reduced redundancy, and a new modular virtualized network can be reconfigured without recabling. A large new operations area was also built to allow each operator to have a clear view into the new data center, as well as a video wall for effectively monitoring and managing the data center and other operations. In machine learning, the city recently installed a more advanced graphics processing unit capable of handling 2.5 quadrillion, with a Q, floating point operations per second. This will allow the city to take advantage of the computational ability of machine learning that were only even imagined several years ago. Some of the projects we are pursuing include machine learning to read handwritten images and extracts of text for cataloging for the Department of Planning and Permitting. And our CRM, the Constituent Relationship Management System, the deployment of OneView will enable City and County of Honolulu leaders to manage and streamline citizen engagement and communication. It will allow the City and County of Honolulu to efficiently respond to citizen requests and complaints and streamline the allocation of government services. And with respect to DPP and the DPP scanning, the Department of Planning and Permitting has microfilm and Aperture Cards archives of decades worth of building plans and permit documents. The DIT will perform semi-automated imaging of this material and utilize machine learning to detect the images and extract text for cataloging. Digitizing these records will allow customers to access the documents online instead of having to physically come down to the city. And lastly, Hanama Bay Online Reservation. for fun and recreation. Our Hanama Bay online reservation system allows the public to reserve an entry time into the nature preserve, while our PROS management system for the Department of Parks and Recreation expands our summer fun program. I want to talk about our emergency services department. In addition to this innovative work, we're also transitioning our emergency services department, or EMS, to a city-funded and operated agency away from the state. Now, I trust we all know and greatly appreciate that EMS has been the frontline medical responder for COVID in our communities, and on a daily basis are the unsung heroes in saving lives. An example of our ability to improve service to the public is that we have recently added EMS coverage by increasing the Makiki and Ever Beach ambulance service from 12 hours to 24 hours a day. And we've also added 29 lifeguards to our ocean safety team to cover our beaches while extended hours of coverage, known as dawn to dusk, by converting to a 10-hour shifts for portions of our ocean safety team. And HPD, our Honolulu Police Department. A year ago today, I reported that in order to balance the city's budget, we elected to impose a hiring freeze except for our first responders. That decision was driven by economic necessity. However, despite that circumstance, we're also committed and determined not to compromise the safety of the public. And at that time, we had more than 300 openings in our police department. And we also had personnel deficiencies with our other first responders in ocean safety, EMS, and our fire department. And after only several months from announcing a hiring freeze, we ended that hiring freeze. However, despite our ramped-up recruiting efforts across all the city's departments, we still have approximately 322 openings today in our police department. In fact, the city and county of Honolulu currently has more than 3,000 vacancies. And adding greatly to that daunting fact is that 15% of our current workforce is eligible for retirement. Now, this situation has been years in the making, and consequently, we have made investing in our people and recruiting a very high and necessary priority. So we're in the process of revamping inefficient processes that have hindered us from producing more effective hiring results, and we are going to recruit aggressively. Now, I really sincerely want to acknowledge the very hardworking men and women today who work for the city and county of Honolulu. However, their efforts and that of the leadership of our cabinet team are severely compromised in reaching our potential and serving the people of Oahu as a result of these staffing shortages. The number of people required to get the job done in many areas are simply not there, causing frustrating and unnecessary delays. Lastly, and this is a point of contention for me, the process of naming our next chief of police has taken far too long. And I'm choosing to be optimistic that we'll have this important decision finalized in the near term. The Office of Climate Change, Sustainability, and Resiliency. You know, we cannot consider ourselves a modern city if we're not doing everything possible on the subject of climate change, especially as island dwellers. Our administration released and City Council adopted the city's first ever climate action plan, a community-driven strategy for Oahu to combat climate change, increase city sustainability, and work with communities to build a more resilient Oahu. We will implement projects, programs, and grants by working with community partners and various city departments to ensure our community is ready to address climate change impacts facing our island home, such as rising seas and warmer temperatures. You know, climate resilience requires both preparing communities for impacts and climate action reducing greenhouse gas pollution, which fuel these growing concerns. At the large scale, we're in the process of engaging community for their input on two very important projects for the future of Oahu. We are now partnering on new concepts with the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers to address very serious flooding risks in both the Alawai Canal watershed and the Vailele Stream through Laie. These are both essential long-term projects to provide community security in the face of seasonal and heavy rains, storms that can be tracked in advance, and very difficult and dangerous rain bombs and flash flooding. We're also investing in our future with electric buses. We currently have a fleet of 17, reducing our dependence on expensive fossil fuel. providing cleaner and quieter community connections for Keiki to Kapuna, and continuing the legacy of first-class public transit with the bus. And finally, I'm also very pleased to announce that Honolulu was recently recognized as one of three most improved U.S. cities in a notable national survey of cities taking clean energy and transportation action to address changes in our climate while improving our communities. Department of Customer Service, if this doesn't say it all for everything we're doing when I talk about this department, customer service. In the area of the Department of Customer Service, or CSD, the elimination of the city's backlogs in driver's licenses, state IDs, motor vehicle registrations, and dealer transactions hit us right in the face as soon as we walked in the door. At the beginning of 2021, the city experienced an unusually large carryover of expired driver's licenses and state identification cards from the prior year due to COVID-19 shutdowns and social distancing protocols, which also coincided with the year 2021, when the volume of renewals was scheduled to be very high anyway. But by implementing a strategic combination of staff overtime, operational streamlining, equipment updates, and contract staffing, CSD was able to meet the demand of the backlog together with the current expirations to catch up with all renewals by the end of 2021. CSD doubled its processing output for monthly renewals. And in addition, the backlog of motor vehicle renewals were eliminated from more than 6 weeks to the accepted time of 10 business days. An accumulated 6 to 8 week dealer registration backlog was addressed by deploying satellite City Hall staff and overtime. And the current turnaround time for dealer transactions has gone from 6 to 8 weeks. It's been reduced to an acceptable time frame of 6 days or less. And for the first time in many years, the CSD has committed to answering phone calls from the public regarding driver's licenses, state IDs, and motor vehicles. You know, in January of 2021, the first month we were in office, our staff answered an average of 7% of more than 3,000 calls that were coming in each day. 7% of 3,000 calls coming in each day. Those are not good numbers by anybody's imagination. The CSD deployed a hybrid outsourced call center with internal staff expertise to respond to calls. And by the end of December, the call volume had been reduced to an average of 1,200 per day, with more than 80% of the calls picked up and responded to. As an example of the impact of this new call center approach, in 2020, the no-answer complaints from the public averaged 78 complaints per week. And by the end of 2021, the number of no-answer complaints averaged 5 or less, and in some weeks was 0. That's a tremendous achievement in serving the public. I want to talk about something very cool right now, and that's the launch of the city's first chatbot, or known as Akamai. CSD launched the city's first chatbot on its website, which is conversational artificial intelligence, or AI, and we've called it Akamai. Now, the chatbot instantly answers the simplest and most frequently asked questions from thousands of Oahu residents in quick voice or text responses. Akamai allows the public to access information easily via our website and is now able to respond and communicate in several different languages. Now, this innovation assists the public and reduces the need for people to speak to a live agent on the phone, which creates efficiencies in our business operations and ultimately a much improved customer experience, which is a great segue to our Department of Parks and Recreation. Our Department of Parks and Recreation recently signed an agreement with Noresco, an innovative energy service company that will provide energy savings and help us beautify our parks by decreasing DPR's utility, which is the water and electrical and chemical costs. And I would be remiss in not mentioning that last summer, in the midst of COVID, our Department of Parks and Recreation Summer Fund program was made possible by the combined efforts of our maintenance, recreation, and support staff, registering a total of 5,425 participants at more than 65 sites. And furthermore, the Summer Fund Food Service Program fed 3,416 participants at 40 sites. And this summer, we're planning to bring Summer Fund back to pre-pandemic levels, where we can serve 9,000 youths with over 5,000 in Title I, communities, receiving additional services and enrichment activities to help offset the loss of social skills and educational levels they suffered due to the pandemic. Now, this will include lunch and enrichment activities such as field trips to wonderful city lands such as Kualoa Cultural Beach Park, one of our botanical gardens, the zoo, or Hanama Bay. Bravo, Laura, to you and to Kehau. Now, COVID has left us with an incredible task of rebuilding our economy. And a cornerstone of our efforts to help build and reshape our economy is in the Department of Office of Economic Revitalization. And in order to reshape our local economy is our Oahu Back to Work program. Simply stated, this is about helping people who were adversely affected by the pandemic find good jobs that pay well. The City and County of Honolulu partnered with the University of Hawaii Community Colleges to offer free job training for in-demand jobs in technology and business, healthcare, education, clean energy, and skilled trades. And we are fully committed to improving and updating Oahu Back to Work for 2022. And I'm especially proud to talk about the Rent and Utility Relief Program, which is also in that department. It was the city's largest COVID relief program and the foundation of equitable recovery. It has helped more than 11,189 families who are truly struggling, has injected over $123 million into our economic recovery since starting last year. And we're also hopeful to be able to distribute another $65 million in the months ahead. Now, a special note, the program and our partners, Catholic Charities Hawaii and the Council for Native Hawaiian Advancement, they played a major role in preventing a landslide of newly homeless families when the governor's eviction moratoriums ended in the fall of 2021. And I'm especially proud and very grateful to report that Honolulu has been nationally recognized by the Department of Treasury as one of the top performing rent relief programs in the country. We've been able to provide considerable financial relief to our most vulnerable families all around Oahu. But OER's North Star is establishing important careers that will benefit Oahu's economy away from the 20th century and toward a more promising, emerging economy. So we have a three-part plan for the future. First is to preserve good jobs through business relief funds and other support, as well as employee skill-building opportunities. OER will deploy funds from the American Rescue Plan and other sources to provide relief and help rebuild important employers. We want to create careers through technical assistance for businesses, nonprofits, and farmers, fund programs for entrepreneurs, and invest in key economic sectors. The OER will invest in the creation of new good jobs that will replace old jobs that are being displaced by the pandemic, technology, or a shifting global economy. We'll also help people find work by supporting struggling individuals to get back on their feet, by training people and offering career placement and skill building for entrepreneurs. You know, the OER will do more than stabilize people. We will help them retain the work they already have or train them for a more promising and sustainable new career. Chinatown. Despite the many obstacles we knew we were facing, compounded by disillusioned local residents and businesses, who had endured years of broken promises, we made a strong commitment to beautifying, revitalizing, and improve a much-needed security in Chinatown, the crown jewel of the downtown corridor. And last February, 1 month after we took office, our entire cabinet walked through all the streets in Chinatown to see firsthand what needed to be done. And on March 15th last year, in our State of the City address, a year ago today, we made public our commitment to revitalize Chinatown, knowing full well we would be held accountable to deliver on that promise. So in early May, we delivered a two-page list of initial commitments from 8 of our city departments to the Chinatown Neighborhood Board, advising them we would deliver. And since that time, we have worked diligently and delivered many items on that initial list of priorities, including an increased police presence and enforcement in our efforts to revitalize Chinatown. But maybe most notably, after 35 years of operating their ministry and providing free meals to the homeless, the River of Life Mission will continue their ministry but relocate their feeding operations outside of the Chinatown area. And by every account, This development is very significant, and we sincerely acknowledge and thank the good people of the River of Life Mission for working with us to make this possible. You know, we've made no small plans for Chinatown, and in the months ahead, more and more of our efforts will become readily apparent. And this is an ongoing commitment, and we've only just begun. I would be remiss in the State of the City address on a very personal level if I didn't talk about our support of culture and the arts. The list of what we want to achieve for the city and county of Honolulu during our time in office is a long one. And that list begins with providing the most basic of our core city services and expands into innovative and transformative programs and initiatives designed to enrich the lives of our diverse community. And at the heart of our aspirations, we believe supporting our cherished cultures and the arts that commemorate the legacy of our past, help us celebrate the world we live in today, and offers hope to all of us for a better tomorrow is something we simply must do. Honolulu is unlike any other city in the world. We live in a place with such a rich heritage of both our native Hawaiian host culture and the many other peoples and languages that make this special place home. So whether it's through our commitment to revitalize Chinatown, hosting a major international art exhibition like Hawaii Triennial 2022, or through our support for the Festival of Pacific Arts and Culture in 2024, we resolve to preserve Honolulu's diverse cultures and support creative expressions of every kind. I believe that this commitment to the arts and to our community fundamentally grounds our administrative philosophy, creates a culture of inclusivity, and enhances our drive to serve the people of Honolulu. I have every confidence that our Office of Culture and the Arts will prove the city and county of Honolulu to be a supportive and collaborative partner to our incredibly talented and passionate creative community. I want to personally extend a heartfelt word of thanks, respect, and appreciation to our manager and chief engineer of the Board of Water Supply, Mr. Ernest Lau, and his deputy manager and chief engineer, Ms. Ellen Kitamura, for their courage, strength, and determination in dealing with the Red Hill incident. Your vigilance on this very dangerous situation epitomizes dedication and service to the public. So on behalf of the City and County of Honolulu, we extend our deepest gratitude, pride, and respect for all of your untiring efforts. Bravo. Well done. I want to close by once again acknowledging our team and members of the City Council for embracing the leadership challenges we face together at this moment in time in our city. You know, we make no small plans because of the time and circumstance we face together. Now, I've come to embrace a feeling of responsibility in my role as mayor, unlike anything I've ever known before. And yet, I am so deeply encouraged because I know that I am not in the challenge of a lifetime alone because of all of you. And because of all of you, I am most confident things will not only get better, but they have the potential to be the best they have ever been. So on behalf of my wife, Karen, and our families, we sincerely thank you for this incredible privilege to serve the city and county of Honolulu. God bless all of you. Thank you.